back. I'm at Powertune. We got Chia with me. And today we are showing you the ultimate EVO 10. I've got to admit, I don't know a single thing about this car and I've only just jumped in it. I'm pretty blown away already, but this is the latest creation from the Powertune headquarters. And Chia's going to tell us all about it. Obviously, there's a lot to explain here. And I'm just going to keep rattling and hopefully we can remember everything you've done, because it's literally pretty much like the 34 GDR you recently done, the blue one.
Yeah.
You pretty much rebuilt this thing from like ground up,
yes.
Basically.
Yeah.
The whole car. So.
Yeah.
The whole idea behind this creation, basically make it the most insane car you can while keeping it street legal. Yes.
Yeah. Always. Yeah. That's always the goal, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, I don't even know if I've been in an Evo 10 before, to be honest. So, for me to go in something like this straight away,
this is good. This is gonna be funny.
All right. So, what we're gonna do before we even take off, I'm a bit confused because like there's no gear shifter, there's no like column shift. what's going on here? Like, is it? I'm confused. You got paddles.
Yes, but yeah. So originally it's an SST version, so normally it's a gear stick, is here.
Yep.
And that's the, when you put it in manual mode, it shifts the transmission. So factory has got a dual clutch or twin clutch, or wet clutch system.
Yep.
We originally tried to build this car, an SST, maybe 2 years back, but heaps of sort of little issues, you know, sort of kept not performing best at all times.
With the factory
SST, yeah. Stuff, when this car was actually white. I think the development on that transmission and the electronics for that transmission is just not there.
Yeah.
So
was the power an issue?
No.
It was
no.
Just...
Power was still a standard engine and it was making, I think it's 300 kilowatts.
Yep.
But yeah, it's just the transmission was the biggest problem in this car. Right. The factory transmission. So yeah, so it's normally a factory stick here.
Yep.
Which you can, you know, you put over to manual mode once it's in drive and that's the gear shift, right?
Oh, okay, cool.
Yeah.
So what have you done to change? You've obviously got rid of that trans.
Yeah, so it runs a Holland just sequential now.
Hey?
Yeah.
How?
Yeah, it's a sequential, but it's a paddle shifted gearbox.
Oh, what?
Yeah. So we use this just as now we'd obviously put our little control.
Okay, so I'm completely confused here. So it's a Hollinger sequential.
Yeah.
But you've got.
So we use the original paddle shift like system.
Yeah.
Right, to control the Hollinger transmission.
Wow. So it's all electronic.
Yeah. Yeah. It's actually like there's a pump in the back with the tank.
Yeah.
And it's actually a pneumatic shifted, but we use, obviously these are electronically controlled to the solenoids.
Yeah.
Then activate the pneumatic system.
Jesus.
Yeah.
So is that like a normal thing, Hollinger?
Yeah, a lot of the, like, race cars, you can set them up like, with a paddle shift system or a lever. So it's just a normal sequential transmission.
Yep.
Like anything with a lever.
Yep.
But to control the gear shift, there's an actuator.
Jesus.
That's run for air pressure. That's told what to do when we press the lever.
And there's no issues street driving with that at all.
Yeah, I mean it's obviously not as smooth as a synchro gearbox.
Yeah.
But it's smooth.
Wow.
Yeah.
Oh, we're about to find out, guys.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, that's good.
So, if you guys can see that, there's obviously the down shift there, and then the up shift on that side. So it's pretty much like a Formula One car style. That's what I can relate it to, anyway.
Yeah.
But and as you would have also seen that dash, what the hell? That's obviously not factory.
Yeah. So again, that's a Motec C1212.
Wow. Is that the biggest one they do?
Yeah, it's the biggest one they do.
And you've even, is this all?
That's the factory mold, but we had to put some little extensions on the corners to fit them in.
Oh, no joke.
Yeah, because it's normally round here.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
It looks factory. That's freaking incredible.
Yeah, man. That's coming real good.
And then you've... And this... What and is this?
Motec rotary dial.
So what does that do when you turn it?
So right now, this is actually controlling the dash. So it changes the page layout, for example.
Yeah.
So easy. It activates, again, our launch system, traction control, pit speed.
What?
It's got a sub-menu system. Check this out.
Hang on.
Right. Check this out. It's our sub-menu system. So let's go to our boost. Let's choose our boost setting. Low boost, medium boost, high boost. Let's say, example, we choose medium boost. You can see at the top went to normal up in the middle there, at the top of the screen. If I go back in there, kill mode. Like shift mode. Oh, this is actually something that I'm working on currently as well. So
yeah.
Shift mode. So manual is like, yeah, obviously you have to shift it manually.
Yep.
And then there's auto mode, where the computer, once we sort of map it, the computer will actually shift the car for you.
Oh, what?
Yeah. So there's that. What's that? Got throttle maps in there.
EU settings.
Oh, there's another good one. Launch RPM.
Oh, yeah.
Hang on a second.
So you can adjust the launch RPM.
Damn, where are we?
Okay, so all these screens that are custom made for the Motec, they're all done in-house at Powertune. So as you can see, he's added like the little Powertune logo, the Mitsubishi one on the right. You can literally like put whatever you want on the screen, and I'm actually going to do a video about that so we can get into detail with that. But obviously with the C1212 dash, you've got so much more room because the screen's bigger. I'll be doing it on the RBM3 with the C127 dash. And yeah, it's going to be pretty damn cool. But let's get straight into it, I think, Chia, because I think there's a lot more to tell on this. Oh, wow. It's real. I didn't even hear it going gear.
Yeah, sometimes it just...
So weird, like it's got a Hollinger sequential but no stick.
And how many times have I driven it, jumped in it, and
yeah,
done like that.
That is really smooth, eh? Considering,
yeah.
It's a heck of a lot.
It's actually got the carbon clutch I was telling you about last time.
Oh, what brand?
ATS.
The ATS carbon. Yeah. What, triple plate?
Yeah, triple carbon.
This thing is so cool. And it's even got, like, obviously the down blimp.
Yeah.
Set up. So
yeah, it has the throttle blimp.
It doesn't even feel like a race car right now. It's just cruising.
Once we finish our coffee, we'll...
Yeah, we're not going to do the cup holder review in this car. As we see how much power they can handle.
Oh, yeah? Yeah.
So we're actually going to get some fuel. And there is a new fuel station in town, apparently.
Yeah, man. I didn't actually know until like a few weeks ago.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, man. There's a...
Oh, so this is open to the public all the time?
Yeah, man. I think it closes at in the afternoon sometime.
Yeah.
But, yeah, anybody can go here.
So here we are. We just pulled in Sydney Motorsport Park, and this is, like, literally out the back of Powertune. So...
See that? That's the pump.
Oh, yeah. A little compressor.
Yeah.
I just heard a compressor in the back. That's to help with the shifting.
Good day, how are you?
Good.
What are you guys here for?
Fuel.
Fuel? Okay, yeah. No worries.
As I said, takes off the clutch
out. Oh, yeah, where? So you never use a clutch after you've taken off?
No.
So you only, it's literally the same as a Formula One car. You use the clutch to take off, and then it's just paddle shifting for the rest of your journey. This would be the ultimate cruiser. It's lazy ass.
It is. And you can put it in auto mode as well. Say that as well.
So auto mode's working?
Works. It needs a bit of refining, but
yeah.
Yeah, definitely. It's working.
I'll never get over that. That's so weird. And it's not like jolty either.
Yeah.
It's real smooth, eh? Alright guys, so I've just put fuel in it for Cheer. He's got a call with a customer. So while we've got the opportunity here, I just want to explain what has actually happened from the get-go with this. So this was a dead stock Evo 10 when it rolled into Powertune. It was actually white. So the owner asked to do a full colour respray. So the boys at Powertune literally stripped every single nut and bolt. Stripped the whole car completely back to a shell. Sent it off to get painted. It was painted, the whole, you know, inside, outside, everything. And then it was brought back to Powertune and they reassembled it with everything in it now. I'm gonna go into a lot more detail with the engine and then the diffs and everything like that so you guys understand. It's really loud out here. But yeah, this car is honestly ridiculous. Like when you think about it, like you strip the car all the way back to a bare chassis and you pretty much start from scratch. It's freaking cool. And you know, it's a testament to what Powertune do. So I'm excited to tell you all about everything around it. We'll just wait for Cheer to get back in the car and then we'll go from there. How freaking cool is the whole Hollander setup? I've never seen anything like it. It's nuts. So freaking cool. All right, so we got the fuel. Is it full?
Yeah.
So you've even got the level sensor and everything in the Motec.
Yeah.
So with all the Motec, you've obviously got M150 in this.
This runs at M130 actually.
Oh, M130.
Yeah, because it's a four cylinder.
Yep.
You can run the eight injectors. Stage sequentially, no problem.
Don't ever forget that, guys.
Yeah, it's not because I want to sell more injectors. Don't ever forget that. Don't ever forget that.
There's a lot more to it.
Because I wanted to make it run nice. That's all.
So in saying that, right, you've now got the M130 in here. What happens with all the standard functions of this car? Are they out the window?
Nah, man.
No?
Nah, this is a good one. So this system, because this is a late model car,
yep.
2007, I think it's tomorrow actually, in a second. Then we get back here. What is this car?
Anyway, it's a new style car with all your aircon,
so everything's actually
GPS, all that stuff.
Yeah, everything's actually runs on a CAN bus. You know what a CAN bus is?
Well,
you've heard of it, haven't you?
I've heard of it.
Yeah.
But if you can explain it quickly.
Alright, so it's pretty much just two wires that loop around your car.
Yep.
Can high, can low. And it sends heaps of data and messages in sequence over these two wires, which all different parts of the car will use to do what they need.
Yep.
Like ABS, computer, even the climate control, steering angle sensor, brake pressures. So
all that standard stuff, if you were to put an aftermarket ECU on a car, like any generic aftermarket ECU, you pretty much got to sacrifice losing all that, yeah?
Yep.
But with the Motec, you retain everything.
Yeah, because you can actually get the ECU to write, so to broadcast the same messages that the original cars, like microcomputers,
yep,
are expecting. So they keep happy. So like if the ECU just keeps broadcasting these messages to your other computers,
yep,
everything's happy. There's no break in the system.
Okay.
So everything keeps working. So that's what the Motec can do.
Yeah. Yeah. So you've basically made the Motec still read all the other computers and sensors that the car had
simply. Yeah. Yeah. And broadcast messages that they need to see.
Yep.
Yeah.
So there's, yeah. Obviously, you don't have the factory dash, but even if you did, you wouldn't jump in the car and have all these warnings come up and whatever.
Yeah, we actually got a plug and play kit for an Evo 10.
Oh, so you can literally buy a pack off you.
Yep.
That'll be a plug and play and still retain all the factory.
Yep.
Is that just for Evo?
Oh, no, we've got a few different cars.
for like Subarus, like 2008, 2018.
Wow.
GDRs, all the 32s, 33, 34.
Yeah, right.
Silvias, all the EVOs.
So if you guys are after that, you've got a really nice street car and you never wanted to put aftermarket ECU in because you didn't want to lose all the factory stuff. Powertune now actually do the Motec kit, which retains all the factory settings and everything. So
if you guys... Cruise control's another big one.
Oh, still retain that as well.
Oh, man.
So if you guys are keen on that, I'll chuck a link in the description. It'll go straight to the Powertune website. This thing is so cool. Jesus Christ. It's got some punch. All right. I've lost where I was now. Oh, Jesus.
Just get that boost.
He just put it on high. Alright, so
start again.
Where was I? I think I was explaining the fact. Oh yeah, if you want to get a Motec kit for your factory, or you know, your road car, hit up Powertune, because they do a full plug and play kit now. That's crazy. So you're obviously still developing more cars and...
Yeah, we want to make it more accessible to on your platforms.
Yep.
The reason why you can't modify new cars to a big extent is because you lose so much of the car.
Yeah.
You can run the engines, but you can't actually run the car. So we're actually
changing that.
Yeah, we're changing that and trying to give people more platforms to tune on.
That's crazy.
Yeah, man.
That's freaking nuts. So this is a factory dash, yeah?
Yeah, that's a factory stereo. It comes with the display of the climate control, everything as
yeah.
Well.
Yeah. So aircon, everything's controlled in there.
Yeah.
And it still works.
Yeah, man.
Wow. Absolutely. What else can you tell me about this chair?
Inside the cabin.
He's gonna let the driving do the talking. Have you had this thing down the drag strip?
Not yet. It's ready to go though.
Yeah, we're gonna make that happen.
Actually, there's another cool one there now, but actually, yeah, I've actually got a. These cars are prone to like engine bay temps and actually fires. There's been heaps of reported fires on these type of car. This car, the Evo 10, because the turbos are in the back between the engine and the firewall.
Yep.
It's it doesn't get much airflow across there, so we've actually made some ducting actually to direct it over the turbo.
Yeah, right.
The other thing I have is a sensor in the engine, like around there. It's got bay temp.
Yep.
So it monitors for that reason. You know, it's, yeah.
Do you know how many sensors you've got on this car?
I don't know exactly.
Again, but there's a lot.
It's pretty much like there's an M130 ECU. The E888 and all the inputs and outputs are taken on that.
Wow.
The dash had to be enabled to get the inputs and outputs on that to work. There's a lot of that.
So the E888 is an expander box to give you more inputs and outputs, in case you guys didn't know that.
Yeah.
So in other words, there's even more sensors than what's on my Beamer in this thing. So obviously you're checking literally everything, and then doing what the Motec does best, monitoring everything, and if there is any issues, the Motec looks after it.
Yeah.
Or you can just sit there and keep driving.
On this car, we actually, I even put a fuel cooler on as well.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
So just the air, like an...
It's like a normal oil, like a
yep.
Oil cooler.
Yep.
Okay. It's...
Was there a reason for that, or...?
Yeah, because it runs 98 as well, this car. I was just trying to get... 98 to perform at its optimum, you know, all the time.
Yep.
Engine bay heat soak is bad, you know, and so like 85, it helps with big difference?
Yeah, man, this, I wouldn't say big difference, but I noticed a difference. I think it was worth the exercise.
Yeah.
So I actually got a, I got a temp sensor before and after the cooler. And that goes in between. So it goes also between beginning of the fuel rail.
Yep.
And the end of the fuel rail. So we measure the efficiency of the position of the oil cooler, sorry, the fuel cooler as well. So we can see. Because the location we put it, it's compact and it's just there to monitor.
Yep.
As well. It gives me data and feedback.
So with that, on the fuel subject, what's the fuel system on this? Do you still run electronic pumps?
Yeah, this runs two Warbro 460s in the tank. I'm sorry, in the engine bay.
Yep.
In the surge tank. A bit of dash 10 hose. Be no more than 500 mil long. It's a short run to the fuel rail.
Yep.
And it runs, yeah, 8 injectors and twin fuel rail.
So it doesn't have a mechanical fuel pump?
No.
No. With this car, I haven't talked about the engine or anything like that yet, because we'll do that when we're outside and obviously in the engine bay.
You know what actually I really like about this car? It just works really well.
Yep.
That was
just the whole gearbox setup. It's just,
yeah, man,
insane. Like, if you guys just watch Cheer drive it, like, we're obviously in the street. Hey. It's just so simple. Like, anyone next to us or whatever would just assume it's a standard Evo.
Yeah.
Like, there's no loud clunking from the sequential. There's no, like, you can't even hear, like, the straight cut gears. Has it got straight cuts?
Yeah, it's straight cut. Yeah.
Wow. Like, you can hear a little whine, yeah, but it's not that loud, eh?
Yeah.
And the clutch you're using is obviously very streetable.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
It's the best.
And that, if you guys can hear that, is the pump. So that's just the compressor pumping up enough air so you can keep shifting. And that'll never run out, even if you went and did a track day or something.
No, unless it loses power to the compressor.
Yep.
Yeah.
I'm keen to see how this auto works.
Oh yeah, we can do the auto shift.
Yeah. So that's where Chia just sits back. You just need to get the auto steering in your set. So right now, do you have to be, like, stationary or anything?
Just... Yeah, you can do it on the fly, but obviously.
Yeah. So we flicked it into auto. So that's all controlled by this little, what's it called? A Motec rotary switch.
Yeah.
Okay. So if you guys want one of them too, you can also get it from Powertune.
And you got to remember, like, these gearboxes weren't made to go in traffic like this, right?
No.
We're trying to make it do something it was never made for. So,
and it's doing it,
yeah,
very so well.
There has to be compromises.
Yeah.
Like, there has to be some sort of, like, we're trying to minimize the compromise. You have to,
that's just nuts. So obviously that's all programmable through the ECU.
Yeah. So there's actually three different modes. They call it, I think it's called, I'm actually getting it right. Drag mode, corner mode. You could make it if you want. So you can actually, like, put different shift patterns. You can actually just change it. We can create another table.
Yeah.
It's all right. I'm drag racing now.
Yeah.
So my shift RPM in each gear, I want it to be here, whatever it is. Or if you're, like, putting it around here, I want my shift RPM to be example, you know, 1200, 1300.
Yeah.
You know, to get into top gear as soon as I can. It's mappable, so you can actually even choose the type of driving you want, so you can optimize that shift point.
That's nuts.
Yeah.
You can change it back.
Yeah.
Yeah. Can't wait to show you guys the engine. As you would have been able to tell, it's got some punch. So. Yeah, it's freaking. What else can we talk about in here, Chia?
So, oh, the seats—they're all factory.
Yeah, it's all factory interior. Factory interior. That's pretty much, yeah, that's pretty much everything inside the car now. Obviously, it's full Motec catalog, M130, C12, 12-, rotary switch. So this still retains the factory fuse box, all that stuff.
Yeah, everything's.
There's no PDM or anything like that. Wow. still can't get over this friggin' paddle shift. God.
Can't drive a car that smooth. Like a manual car.
Nah.
Can you?
Nah.
And shift that quick.
I'm surprised it's doing it so well.
Yeah.
Like, because I suppose there's no human error, is there?
Yeah, it commits every time you press it. It doesn't. Again, from you.
Yeah.
Now you pull out a different. This is like you hit it. Is it bang?
I just want to keep filming it. But no, we're going to get to the outside now, and we'll show you guys the engine bay and all that sort of stuff. We're just heading back to Powertune now, and yeah, we'll do a full overview of everything on this car, because it's bloody incredible. Alright, we'll be back at Powertune in a sec. So we're just going to show you guys the auto shift setup and how well it works, basically. So, you've already got it activated.
Oh, not yet. I just got it. Turn it on to.
So go into shift mode. Flick it straight over to auto, and it's done. So now your manual car is auto. Simple. So you have to initiate the first gear. And when you think about it, it's pretty amazing for a Hollander to be able to just do that, hey? Isn't it? If it's a normal trans, yeah, whatever, it's an auto. But that's a Hollander straight cut sequential gearbox. That's freaking crazy. Bloody hell. Kind of speechless, eh? What the hell just happened?
Like spun.
Just goes with the fast forward. What the? You just don't expect it at all, man. Like, I'm up in air about, like, you know, I'm putting the GDR in comparison, and I'm like, what the hell? All right, we need to find out what is underneath that freaking engine bay. All right, guys, so as you can see, like, in all honesty, that looks like a... Like, besides the paint and whatnot, it looks like a standard engine bay. Like, until you go right in there, you obviously see the turbo at the back, there's a surge tank over there, and a lot of hours been put in here to make it look factory. Like, that's... Alright, let's... Chia, tell us everything about this engine. Is it a stock Evo 10, like, based engine? Did you start... Well, you obviously started with this engine?
Yeah, it's a standard block. It's the original block.
So the original engine number that come out of this car.
Yeah.
Wow. And rotating assembly.
It's actually got a BC 2.3 litre kit in it.
Yep.
It's got a billet crank, rods and forged pistons.
And then
actually, this is a sleeve motor as well.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, it's actually a sleeve motor. I've actually sleeved it as well. So I've done sleeves in it.
Yeah, right. And the benefit for that?
Strength.
Okay. Yeah. And then into the head is?
It's got just supported head, playing with valve springs, oversized valves, retainers. So it's got camshafts. It's got Kelford camshafts.
Yep. But that's a pretty basic, like, you haven't really done anything crazy there.
No.
With my RB, we do a full shimless bucket setup.
Yes. This engine's actually pretty good.
So with the head, you were telling me that there's some kind of trickery going on there with the VCT. Like, I'm used to the inlet cam being variable, but there's something different with these.
Yeah, no. This engine's factory got a variable inlet and variable exhaust cam.
So both sides are variable?
Yeah, constant variable.
There's not that many engines. Like, do the other EVO engines that have that?
EVO 9 was a variable inlet.
Yep.
And it's the only one. Every other.
Far out.
This is a different generation of engine compared to the EVO 4, 5, 6, 7,
yep.
8, 9. It's different.
Definitely. And then you've got twin fuel rails, I can see here.
Yep. The standard thing that we do, you know.
Yeah.
Eight injector, staged sequentially.
Yep. And I suppose we'll go straight into the turbo side of things. Like, have you had to modify the firewall or anything? Like, how?
No, part of this project was heat management.
Yep.
In the backside of this engine bay.
Oh, so is that what's going on with the?
So we've actually put a duct there to actually force air down that direction.
Yeah, right.
While we're driving.
And obviously,
we've actually made a big heat plate, a little heat shield down there. Everything's insulated, ceramic coated, like whatever we could do. Like,
and I'm sure
prevent.
I'm sure you've got a sensor down there monitoring that.
Well,
classic.
This sensor here actually monitors the air passing through here.
Wow.
And you actually see it on the road how effective it is.
So what else is going on here? So what turbo is that, sorry?
It's a BorgWarner EFR 9174.
The same as my Beamer.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
And you guys seen how it come on like friggin' that? That what? Is that because of the variable cam timing? Or?
Yeah, this is to do with gear ratio.
Also,
I've actually put a close ratio gear set in this as well. So that, the engine too, being variable cam, you can actually optimise, you know, a bigger power band.
So for an RB guy like myself to get the same, you'd have to go with a V-cam?
V-cam, yep.
Yep. So that does the exhaust? No.
Inlet cam.
Inlet cam.
Yep.
So we can't do an exhaust cam as well, can we?
No, not yet.
Wow. So that's a huge advantage that this engine has.
Yeah.
And then moving on from that, we've got, is that a surge tank?
Yeah, so it's got an engine-based surge tank.
Yep.
It's got two Warbro 460s in there.
Yep.
And that's fed from the back through a Warbro 255.
So you've just got a lift pump in the boot?
Yeah.
And is that the same reason you did with like the GDR to make the boot space readily available?
Yeah.
So,
again, picks up the original factory feed and return line. So,
right.
Front to the back, it's all original.
So, with all the piping,
yeah,
is that, it looks kind of factory? I don't know. Is that because all this, you didn't do all that molding?
Nah, that's actually factory EVO 10.
Wow. So, you've retained all the factory piping.
Yeah.
And get ready for it, guys. What power level is this at?
This isn't actually it's actually 490 kilowatts at the moment.
490 kilowatts at all four wheels.
Yeah. So I've stopped the engine at 8,000 RPM. It's actually making power, and it's like what the Sonvia just now.
Yep.
See how it keeps pulling up, but I've actually I stopped it because I don't want it to rev more than that at this stage.
And as you know, like, because you've seen the footage, how quick it freaking revs, it's insane.
Yeah.
So this car here, guys, is another customer of Powertune's who I would say wanted the exact same outcome as the blue GDR that we recently videoed.
It was standard when he first bought it, and we actually modified it a little bit with the SST. Remember what I was telling you?
Yep, with the standard transmission.
Yeah, so it was a progression too, and to the point where he's like, I can't do anything with SST, where like I was out as well. I was like, this is not getting us anywhere. And then from there, I think it just all right. Okay, let's do this, and escalated.
So the gearbox is a Hollinger 6-speed sequential, as you guys know, with a paddle shift. For that to get integrated into this engine, is that like you go to Hollinger, I need a sequential, it's an off-the-shelf item?
Yeah, it's an off-the-shelf item.
It literally just bolts straight in?
Yeah, that's it.
So you don't need no transfer case issues, no diff issues?
This is using the standard EVO 10 transfer case and EVO 10 rear diff.
And the diffs are factory still?
Yeah, it's a factory.
Both of them?
Yeah.
So they're not... Well, yeah. Yeah, that's pretty surprising.
Yeah.
And the shafts, like...
Yeah, it's all factory.
All factory?
Yeah.
And you've never had any issues?
Not yet, no.
Far out.
Oh, I've actually changed it. Actually, you know what I've done to you? I've actually changed the throttle body size.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Yeah, so factory, they're drive by wire factory anyway.
Yeah. So the throttle body's down here.
Yep, there is. You can't see him.
Nah, not very well.
Yeah. Yeah, so I've actually put a Bosch 82mm throttle body on it.
Yep.
We've actually modified the factory inlet manifold.
So it's got a factory inlet manifold too, and you've integrated the 8 injectors and also a different electronic throttle.
Yeah.
And
you couldn't actually buy one. We actually looked at any aftermarket support we actually developed one. At the time, there wasn't.
So there's no aftermarket?
Not that I know of.
Far out.
And I think I've actually seen a few race ones, but they look...
Yeah.
It was like sheet metal.
Obviously, guys, you know, this had to stay as a street car. The sole purpose of it was obviously to retain a factory look, factory drive.
Yeah, it is.
Drivability.
You know, that's always the philosophy, you know?
Yeah.
It's actually trying to get that... a race car, but driving it every day and
so when you usable. When you actually think about it, you're literally building a supercar.
Yeah, I think it is.
Like that's pretty much what it is. You've got the ability to go down the shops every day, get your groceries, whatever. You can drive it to work every day, and then you can literally not change a single thing besides the high boost setting, and go to the drag strip on a Wednesday night, run probably a 10. We're gonna find out that. And then you can take it on the weekend to the track and circuit race it, like, without changing a single thing on the car.
Yeah.
Honestly, it's better than a Lambo.
You've been in it now, so...
Like, it's...
You don't expect it when you're putting around. You don't expect anything from this car too much. And then when you actually,
Give it some, it's freaking ridiculous.
Yeah, nothing like what you even imagined. Judging by, you know, going by the way it idles and stuff like that.
Like, it just comes across as a standard Evo that someone's just put an exhaust on.
Yeah.
That's a huge testament to what Powertune can do. Like, they've literally... Like, how many people can go to a workshop, say, oh, I want my standard car to stay basically standard driving along the street, but yet chuck 500 kilowatt in it, please?
Yeah.
Like... When you think about it, it's incredible.
Yeah.
You look at this engine bay, it looks pretty well standard. Like, obviously it's all painted. You can just see the turbo at the back. The surge, like, honestly, it does look pretty standard. It's not like a race engine bay where, like, you look at my Sombia and it's all ridiculous. You look at the Beamer, it's ridiculous. And it's at the same power figures, if not, well, it's more, heaps more than the Sombia. And then you look at around it, it's, like, it is a supercar. It really is. Like, you can't...
It depends who you ask, I guess.
I know that, but, you know, you can buy a Lamborghini for, what, $1 million or something? And you can buy this for... Come to Powertune, and I guarantee you can probably get a couple of them for $1 million. And you'd chop Lambos for days in this thing. Wow. I'm still blown away. Like, the worst thing... I love this thing, but I also hate it because I'm questioning the GDR. And I'm a GDR, like, purist. You know, like, It's just incredible. Man, I'm going to want to cut this out the video, but I can't. Oh, I'm keen to know what you guys think of this. Obviously, you don't know, you know, the feel of it in the passenger seat, but man, full credit to your chair. This thing is just absolutely incredible. I did tell you guys when we were getting fuel in this that when you did do the transmission swap, that's when you actually stripped the entire car. Was that right?
Yeah, when we actually done the transmission and when we rebuilt the engine again.
You stripped the entire car down to get resprayed.
Yeah.
Every nut and bolt completely out from the inside. The thing's got airbags. It's even got heated seats still.
Everything, because we didn't want the panel beaters to pull it apart because you know what that's like.
Yep. Totally understand.
Like little clips and stuff that just go missing. And
where did you keep everything? This would have been scattered everywhere.
Nah, not scattered. I lost my shit.
Cheers, like a clean freak.
Yeah.
So and if things go like in the wrong spot in the workshop, they go in the bin.
Yeah. So that was one of the things that we wanted. That I asked the owner to do is as long as we could strip it. Confident that it was going to go back like originally.
Yeah. And it has.
Yeah.
I still can't get over it. Like, you're going to drive this home tonight, like it's just a daily. And then
this car makes me happy every time this car makes me happy every time I drive it. It's like,
you got to be freaking proud of this.
Yeah.
So, and also, if you guys haven't seen the blue 34 GDR video, I'll chuck it thing right here now and you can go check that one out. But this one's actually what I really want to, I'm sure everyone else wants to know too, time frame.
Yeah.
How, if someone come into this shop with a standard Evo 10, how quickly could you turn it around into something like this if they rocked up tomorrow and said,
I mean, with good planning you could do this within 6 months.
6 months.
Yeah, 6 months. That's painting the car, everything. That's obviously getting the car sent out, stripping it, everything.
And just so you guys know, ordering, say, a Hollinger, that's like 14-week wait.
Yeah, up to 14 weeks.
And that's just the gearbox. So to do this in 6 months, I honestly think you'd be pushing it, but hell. So if you want your Evo like this, you best be hitting the link in the description and getting in touch with Chia here. God. Even overseas people, like, all these people buying Lambos, Ferraris, you can save yourself so much money and have an even better car. Yeah, it doesn't look like a Lambo or whatever, but it's exactly what I do. Like, I think all car enthusiasts that actually know everything about what actually goes into these, they'd be jumping on, like, if I won the lotto, I wouldn't be buying a Ferrari or a Lambo.
If you like driving, there's a big difference.
It is a pure driver's car. That's what it is, eh? Like, it's got every element you can think of, besides Outback June buggy racing. Oh, wow. What a freaking car. You've killed it, Chia. Absolutely killed it. And that's perfect timing because we're almost out of battery. Oh, this can be bonus footage, actually. That's what this will be.
Yeah,
bonus footage style. I don't know if you'd get sick of driving this. Well, because it covers every category. You know what I mean?
Yeah. You can drive it. You can relax and drive it.
Yeah. Or you can like.
Oh yeah.
Absolutely thrash the piece. Yeah. Have it like a
does it get off?
Nah.
It's
just on the whole freaking way.
Yeah, exactly. appreciate that. So.
Oh my god, that's just. From a freaking four-cylinder. Oh, it's so good. Some bonus footage for you guys, so if you hung around for that video, you got that treat.
Fun.
Oh man,
fun fact,
that is ridiculous. Thanks, Chia.
No.